So when we talk about Nad Yoga, Nidhi, mostly people think that it is this course will have a lot of I'll be using a lot of instruments, like the instruments that you use in Swaram. But there are two branches of Nad Yoga. One is totally instrumental, where you study the impact of the instruments, what you did in Auroville, and what I'm talking about here is using the sound of your own vocal cords, the sound that is you generate, within, and the sound that you're born with, using that sound to reach the source, the very source from where we all came. So talking a little bit about the history of Nad Yoga, and it's very interesting, Nidhi, that all our scriptures, let me tell you, Vigyan Bhairav Tantra, Hatha Yoga, Pradipika, and then Nadabindu Upanishad, these were written in some 300 BC. And very old scriptures, they talk about Nad Yoga. And there are 20, this Upanishad, Nadabindu Upanishad, is one of the 20 Upanishads that is mentioned in all four Vedas. All four Vedas. So this is highly important. It's a very important subject for yogis. And the reason this is something that I have analyzed, the reason why they never propagated it, it's because people, back then people knew the value of their speech. They would talk very meaningfully. They would, whatever they would be asked to do, they would take it seriously, and they would keep their promises, for example. They would respect the words coming from other people and respect their own words. So they would not use words frivolously. In today's society, you see maybe how people talk meaninglessly. Sometimes they say, "Hi, sweetie, I love you, I miss you," all of that, all these things really don't make sense. Because inside, if you peep into their heart and mind, they don't mean what they're saying. They're not missing the person they're, addressing. They don't love the person they are addressing. For the sake of it, Nidhi, just so that you impress people superficially and the other person knows what you mean, how deep you are, when you say something, how serious you are when you say something. They also know, but now the power of sound has come down, Nidhi. I feel that earlier it wasn't so, and people knew the importance of mantras, they knew the importance of chanting the Upanishadic mantras, the Vedic mantras, then they knew how to pronounce the words, because Sanskrit was the main language in India
Main language,
for
yes.
the Hindus. But now it is all gone. So we are more westernized, but the soul is still Indian, and our samskaras are still there. So I believe that Indians are ready for this kind of knowledge today, because it is in their genetic code, to understand the subject deeply, because our forefathers have been following this.
So
Yeah, so that's what I feel, ki the everybody is made differently. We all come with different sounds. Within us there are so many sounds. So coming back to the topic, how the Nad came into existence, the subject of Nad Yoga, the course, I went to my ashram, and obviously with the grace of my guru Swami Niranjan ji, I learned about this subject. I read about it. They always give, as a prasad, they give us books. And one of the books, very elaborately, it was talking about the subject of Nad Yoga. And then I said, this is something that I was craving to learn about, without even knowing the term, the topic, Nad Yoga. I was yearning to learn about more about music. And it's because as I told you, that any kind of spiritual music would move me and stir me. And it would move my soul. So I didn't understand why. Why would music impact me so deeply? I'm not a singer. I don't even do riyaz back then. Now a little bit I do as a part of Nad Yoga Sadhana. But then I came to know about this, being a separate branch of yoga. And then I learned about it, and I, with the grace of my gurus, I was successful in gaining knowledge of Nad Yoga, which I used, which I now share with people, which I use for my own betterment. So they say in scriptures, they say that initially, before the world came into the universe was created, the two forces existed, the force of Shiva and Shakti. So Shiva and Shakti are opposite forces, but they complement each other. And when they came together, when they came together in the Bindu, and the scriptures talk about the universal Bindu, and we have our individual personal Bindu right here at the curve of the head. But scriptures talk about these two Bindus, the outer universal Bindu and the personal Bindu. So in the universal Bindu, the matter was put together, very closely. So there was no space in the matter between the atoms, between the molecules. There was no space. It was just the dense dark matter. So when the Shakti and Shiva came together, the dormant dead matter came alive, you know, and there was commotion, there was heat, there was vibrations. It came out alive. So obviously it was too closely put together, and this heat created a lot of unrest, and that led to an explosion, a big bang, you know, that, you know, scientists explain it as a big bang theory. And this explosion created the sound of Om. And this sound of Om, you know, which came out of this explosion as a result of union between Shiva and Shakti, this sound started spreading. It's because sound moves, right, from one point to the other. So this sound spread out. And when it spread out, it dispersed, it became weaker in frequency. So the highest frequency is the frequency of Om, Paranath. And then the lower frequencies came into existence. Those lower frequencies are called the Matrikas. And Sanskrit language is based on 50 letters. You know, it has 50 letters, and we're talking about 52 matrikas here. So what is the 51st matrika? It is the light, and the 52nd matrika is the flow of light. You know, because with that blast, with that explosion, the light also came. Heat came, light came, sound came. So all three started moving away from the source. And now our aim is to get back to the source using the same matrikas. So all the Sanskrit verses or mantras are based on these matrikas, because there are 50 letters, and obviously, you know, from those 50 letters, the mantras are made or designed. So when we chant mantras, we invoke the energy of those matrikas, which will eventually take us towards the source. So that is a short description of how the scriptures explain this.
But that's beautiful. And that's
so much
the origin,
power in mantras. You know. That's the origin.
Yeah.
And it's so beautiful how the Western scientists also talk on the same lines, but they use a different terminology for it. They say that in the beginning, let's talk about the scientist Itzhak Bentov. He was an Israeli scientist, and he made a model of the universe. And you can just say roughly it was of the shape of an egg. It wasn't, it was a torp, but let's make it simple. It was a shape of an egg, and at the center of the egg is the nucleus, according to him. The nucleus is the center of the universe. So he's talking actually about the universal bindu. So, and he explains it similar way. He says the matter is very closely put together. There is no space in that matter. That matter is dead and dormant. So the two opposite forces, the north and the south pole, are the Shiva and Shakti. The positive and the negative forces, and they repel each other because, you know, they move in opposite directions because they are different. So, but at some point, as you know, that how the circle completes, they come together. And the point where they come together is the nucleus of the egg from the model of the universe. So that nucleus with these two energies coming together, Shiva Shakti, he calls it negative positive, but it's Shiva Shakti coming together. And like how two currents, negative positive, create electricity, these two currents, they came together and there was a blast then. Now this is the Big Bang theory. And the blast again created the sound, and the matter was scattered everywhere. And, you know, it moved at a very high vibration initially, frequency, and as it moved away from the source, it came to a standstill, and that's how the planets and galaxies and solar systems were made. So that's the Western version of what I told you about, you know, the starting of the universe. So we are all, the whole universe is sonic in nature. We're all sound beings, musical beings. And if you understand the structure of the atom, atom has a nucleus in the center, the protons and neutrons, and around it, electrons appear and disappear randomly, you know. So the movement of the electrons is what is creating sound within the atom. So every atom is generating sound. And because of which we as human beings, you know, one cell, they say, is made out of 50 trillion atoms, and one body approximately 65-70 kgs made out of 50 to 100 trillion cells. So all those atoms coming together, cells coming together, they are creating a symphony. You know, there's huge music being played inside our body. We're not even aware of it.
Yeah, I think what you're saying, because everything has a sound, whether, you know, the vibration starting from our human, or the trees have their own vibration, the yes. things, the air has its own vibration, and there is some sound. There is everywhere, if you just see, there is...
The basic unit itself is, you know, the functional unit, which is atom, itself is creating sound, and everything that matters in this universe is made out of atoms.
Exactly.
Even the things which are not movable, things which are dead, dormant, they all have sound coming out of them. So we
exactly.
have affinity towards a particular color, affinity towards a particular cloth or, you know, fabric, or mm-hmm. some yeah. spaces really suit us. We like it because the frequency matches our frequency. We resonate with the frequency.
So beautifully put. Yes.
So that's Great. How, you know, we also select our friends through those vibrations that we get, receive from them.
Yeah.
We select friends, we select our family, you know, accordingly.